Berlin Wall was perhaps the most defining moment in modern history for us.
I saw what it did to people, how it robbed them of hope.
I found it extremely intimidating.
And it was a dividing line between philosophies, both economically and religiously.
That became a death trap to anyone who tried to get across it.
A direct attack on the human soul.
That wall was as much a spiritual barrier as it was a physical one separating peoples.
We were afraid that the police would come, and if they would catch us, they would put us in prison. I remember that we lived in fear.
Before revolution, I remember staying in line for buying bread.
At that point, you had to wait in line, you know, straight, not leaving, coming and leaving.
Okay. Only pay somebody to stand in line for you.
For you, yeah. That was the new job. Stache was called. Yeah, that would be the rotation, stache.
Stander.
Those who believed in God were either interned out into the mountains, or their families were isolated from the rest of society. They were refused opportunities. They were imprisoned. Many were even killed.
My father, being involved with the Communist Party, he was very careful for us to not talk anything against the Communist Party, because it was very dangerous.
And I remember my friend's father being arrested because he was in Solidarity Movement.
Up until 1989, our campus ministry in Eastern Europe was very limited.
How could we go out and try to initiate and share our faith, because we were so afraid that, you know, the police is chasing after every meeting.
We had maybe 100 expat staff that couldn't, in some cases, even tell their own families where they were living.
I was interrogated by a Polish KGB officer. I could have been thrown out of the country or in prison. And his techniques were both intimidation as well as cajoling and encouraging me to trying to compromise me.
I remember pulling back the curtains of our kitchen, and all of a sudden seeing up high up on the hill was a man standing with binoculars, peering directly down into our kitchen.
You know, they couldn't hold large group outreaches, they couldn't go out and do evangelism. And
the four laws back then was not printed. Okay, I manually typed in a typewriter.
They couldn't host, you know, put up advertisement for Bible studies or other things they were doing on campus.
We couldn't name the Americans. Every American had a code name.
The university student said, after I started turning the conversation to God, he said, "Are we going to talk about God?" And I go, "Well, I'd like to." And he goes, "Okay, well then, quick, we gotta move tables because this one's bugged."
Because we're oppressed in a way and not allowed to hear anything about God, now this curiosity was, okay, let us hear about God. So out of curiosity, I went to this room where these foreigners had come and they were sharing about God.
Kind of there were these winds of changes that started to blow in Eastern Europe.
Back in March of 1989, it began in Poland.
Lech Wałęsa and Solidarity Movement.
May 24th, 1989, Hungarian and Austrian border patrol cutting the Iron Curtain.
They were loading up wire. And I sort of jokingly said to the family, "Oh, look, they're wrapping up the Iron Curtain and taking it down."
And so the East Germans got in their little Trabants with their DDR stickers, and they started going to the Hegye Shalom határ, the border. Border Patrol calls Budapest, "Can we do this? Let the East Germans through."
This was a God thing, that God had done this. This was not just a political movement. On November 9th, 1989, when the Berlin Wall fell, in many ways, everything we knew in Eastern Europe changed at that moment. But there were people around the world that were praying and asking God to tear that wall down and to open the door so that the gospel could go into those countries.
I was there with my East German leadership team planning how to bring them on staff. It was one of the most moving experiences of my life. Larry Thompson was with me. He and I stopped as soon as we got on the West German side, stood by the road with thousands of other people waving and crying.
But then coming behind that was Romania.
I remember that a man saying on television that Ceausescu was executed.
Bulgaria was in January, followed over the course of a 2-year period by other countries, Albania. And in 1991, the very Soviet Union itself.
For 40 years this existed, they were told that there was no God. But from day one when we walked into that country, what we found was that it was very hard to find an atheist.
If you gave someone a booklet for free, that person was very happy and interested.
The word got out that there were American Christians. Waves of students would come, and there were some that spoke English or studying English, and they would translate. And in the first 2 weeks we were on campus, we saw over 200 students that came to faith in Christ.
It was a huge openness during the first Jesus campaign. And I became a Christian through the Jesus film.
In Romania we had a magazine, and we still have a magazine created by students for students. And around that magazine, there was a club, and students were interested to be part of that club.
We were in 10 cities with our campus ministry. Today we're in about 90 cities. When the fall of the wall happened, Christianity wasn't the only thing to come into Eastern Europe.
Everybody came. Playboy, Jehovah's Witnesses, business opportunities.
There's still a lot that needs to be done.
Year by year, we experience more spiritual walls.
Something about spiritual interest and materialism that they don't quite go together.
On the campuses of Eastern Europe, I think the real danger is the despair.
We've seen a lot of progress, we've seen a lot of change, but still the vast majority of students don't hear the gospel. There are different kinds of outreaches which we're doing, one called Story of the Soul, for example, that really takes from modern media the messages that are behind it and the worldview that's behind it, and uses that as a doorway to lead people to an understanding of a relationship with God for which they were made.
Other countries have seen phenomenal expansion around the world. Albanians going to Turkey and the Middle East. Romanians going to China and other places. Ukrainians going to Russia. Poles going to the Ukraine and to Russia.
Annually, our campus ministry is exposing probably at least 400,000 students across the region to the gospel every year.
The basic thing what we did was going to dorm and share Christ through personal evangelism. And that's the basic of our ministry right now too.
If I were to think of one need, one great need today, it's for more leadership.
The best way to reach the country is through the nationals living in that country. And the key thing in that is having right leaders.
And so we want to see them supported, we want to see them trained, we want to see them developed. But with that, to see them raising up other leaders on these campuses.
What I still hope and envision for our lifetime is to see the growth of the church, to see movements of students in universities all across this region.
The gospel is the power, and we boldly proclaim it. God will bless it.
I believe that God still has a great work that He wants to do in my nation.